Good afternoon and welcome, bienvenidos, to the Gilcrease Museum. We are very pleased to have this symposium today that's in conjunction with the Ancient West Mexico exhibit, which I hope all of you have had a chance to go through already. This is an extraordinary presentation of the Gilcrease collection on Ancient West Mexico, and it's an area of the world that I've been privileged to work in for many, many years and was thrilled to find this collection at the Gilcrease when I came here 7 years ago. In addition to the exhibition, we produced three books, a catalog for the exhibit that features all of the objects in the exhibition, an academic volume, some of which you will hear from some of the speakers today, and in addition to that, we've created a lab manual for those who are really hardcore, want to learn a lot about West Mexican figures, and it will be an ebook. Indeed, it's the first ebook ever produced by the Gilcrease Museum, so we're sort of proud of that too. Today, I'm very pleased to be able to introduce to you four speakers, all of whom I've known by name for many years, a few of which I've known in person for many years, and have admired their work, and they all make extraordinary contributions to our understanding of the cultures of ancient West Mexico. The theme today essentially is the view from the field. You're going to be hearing about fieldwork past and present that helps us understand the context of the figures that are in the exhibition in West Mexico. We're also doing another little experiment today, so all of you are kind of our guinea pigs. Two of our speakers will be presenting in Spanish, two will be speaking in English. For the two in Spanish, Dr. Bruce Willis is going to be the online translator, and we hope this all works really well. We've never done this before. We hope you would enjoy it. But it will be, I think, a great opportunity. We'll have four presentations. Please save your questions. And at the end of the last presentation, we'll all stand up here and we will be happy, or they will be happy, to answer questions. So without further ado, I'd like to introduce Dr. Christopher Beekman.
So, thank you very much to Bob Pickering for the introduction. Thank you to the staff of the Gilcrease for arranging all this for us today. And can you hear me if I walk away from the microphone?
No.
Not very well. Okay. I will.
Chris?
Oh! So I can go move on. This is an improvement, I take it. Okay, then. Well, I'm very pleased to be standing here with attending this with my colleagues from Mexico and the United States. And I hope our presentations and discussions will enhance your enjoyment of the West Mexico exhibit. And my talk is going to directly address the ceramic figures and models, like the central piece you see on the slide. And I'm going to argue for the broader topic. I'm going to discuss the broader topic of performance. In the sense, well, you'll see in a minute, but in the sense of, well, kind of what I'm doing right now. I'm up here in front of you, and I'm performing in a way, and how this was a major part of Meso, or ancient West Mexican, Mexican in general, political systems. I'll talk about how I think many of these figures were never intended to go into a tomb at all, and how I think they may well have been used for narrative storytelling. So, see if we can get this to work here. Aha! So, the area of Western Mexico that we keep referring to is part of a larger region known as Mesoamerica. Which includes much of Mexico and extending largely from where we're talking about, down into some distance into Central America. Mesoamerica is probably known to the public for what we call complex societies, but includes things like pyramids, of course, and beautiful objects, prominent public ceremonies, and of course, everyone's favorite, human sacrifice. All of this can easily give the impression that Mesoamerican political systems were quite powerful. But the truth is that often their bases were really quite fragile and depended very much on the political elite carrying out their duties in a very public manner. We'll give you some examples in a minute of ancient Mexico and Central America, but this is also true, of course, of our own world, right? We often have, many countries have a head of state separate from the one who actually manages the government, and much of what they do is very ceremonial, right? Cutting ribbons, giving speeches, and so on. And all these often had to take place in very specific kinds of locations, specially designed for it. Breaches in protocol, as they happen even today, when a president goes to China, that can end up being something in the news, right? But these are different kinds of performance. So consider Maya hieroglyphic texts inscribed on monuments and buildings. Now, while the hieroglyphics are pretty impressive looking and quite detailed and difficult to go through the process of translation, in the end, what they actually tend to say, it tends to be pretty simple. It tends to be something along the lines of so-and-so carried out a ritual or chastised some captives or they danced. Some of the things that they do that are mentioned in these texts are after all the artwork and the elaboration of it, they can be a little bit of a... gee, that's all that? And he just says he danced. Consider what we call monumental architecture. Major sites in Mexico, like Monte Alban in southern Mexico, or Teotihuacan, just outside Mexico City. The big thing, of course, that you see are the very large monuments, the pyramids and platforms and so on at these places. Well, of course, these large buildings are often the settings themselves for different kinds of political performance. Let's say carrying out a ritual, and their height is sometimes one of the important aspects to it, is to increase visibility. And look at the plazas of some of these places like Monte Alban. The plaza here around the major buildings has been calculated as large enough to hold more people than actually are calculated to have lived at the site. So there's very much an emphasis on the public being able to see rulers carrying out their different aspects of their duties. And sometimes the term performance is quite literal. If you look at some indigenous communities in Guatemala today, where they annually perform what's really a pre-conquest play or an actual theatrical play. That sort of like a historical drama for those of you who maybe watch Vikings or something like that, in this particular case of the Rabinal Achi, they're recounting the capture of a major warrior, how he then gets berated by his captor, and eventually he gets sacrificed. And plays like this one are being played out, acted out in front of the community, and it very much intended, of course, to have an audience. But it has a historical component too. It's interesting. We can also take an example closer to the area that I'm talking about today. In the state of Michoacán in western Mexico, there we have an interesting text, the native text known as the Relación de Michoacán. And in there, and in fact right at the beginning, before it goes on to talk about the history of the empire in Michoacán, its formation, all the drama leading up to it, its expansion into a major empire, it describes how on the occasion of the annual ceremony known as the Equita Consuelo, that they would bring people together, especially nobles, but certainly lots of other people, bring them all into a central place where one of the highest ranking priests would then turn and speak to the people and recount those events that are actually then described in the Relación de Michoacán. So the descriptions, they are these recounting of historical narratives to an audience, to a public, is something that dates that goes back quite far, and it's very much a component of societies in ancient Mexico and Guatemala. Now, as to where I work in the western state of Jalisco, part of the broader region we've been calling ancient West Mexico. I focus on the period you see up there, about 800 years long. That's a heck of a period to try and specialize in. But the societies in this region were less politically centralized than those that I've discussed previously, Teotihuacan or Monte Albán or the big Maya cities or something. They tend to be smaller, so you can see, I have a few numbers up here just referring to the size of some of these places, like this site right here with an estimated 4,000 to 6,000 people, another one with an estimate of maybe 1,000 people. These are considerably smaller than, let's say, Maya centers, which may range from 5,000 to 50,000 in size. Now, then nonetheless, the societies in this region, it looks like they relied on this aspect of performance as well. So during the time period that interests me, we have examples of different forms of civic or public architecture. I would rather think these are temples, but I also argue that these are very much places of performance. They're built so as to replicate their idea of the cosmos, which I'll get to in a second. But the circular architectural form here, which you can see just sort of outlined, is very much part of the template. And you can note here how several of these circles are actually connected to one another, kind of like gears. Well, ceramic models, like those that show up in the exhibition, ceramic models have been found that show this architecture in different forms. They show it sometimes with people in it doing things. In this case, we have an example that shows us, that helps to explain how it's a model of the cosmos. So we have here one of these circles with a set of buildings all around in a circular form. And then we actually have two smaller circles of four attached to it. And then you'll notice that this is actually a vessel. You can actually pour water into that, right? You can see the little spout off to one side. And that actually, it's neat how it's worked into the design to what it's trying to convey. So the central piece, this coming out of the basin, is a tree with little birds on it and little people climbing it. And this is making reference to the ancient Mexican Central American concept of the world tree, which is situated at the center of the universe. It's also a kind of conduit between an upper world and our world, here represented largely by the little buildings. And that tree is often associated with a central mountain as well, and it's also kind of a metaphor that's used for rulers themselves. So rulers are kind of, you know, the center of the universe. And then a little cut off over here, perhaps, we have reference to an underworld. So this is a layered model of the universe, and the basin where water would have sat within this model. In Mesoamerican thought, the underworld is thought of as a watery underworld. It's an aspect of the symbolism of the underworld that it has. It's connected to water, and that shows up in a number of different ways and different kinds of artwork in the region. Now, the most dramatic form of performance that must have taken place in these circles is what you see here. And there's some examples. One of these is actually from the Gilcrease, several of these are on display in the exhibit. But these circular temple groups, you can kind of see one of these here, right? You have this big patio, you have a circular pyramid, kind of looks like a wedding cake. And then they have all these temples around the edge. All that we have today are the foundations. You don't have the nice superstructures that you have in these models. But you see, the model shows this pole, right, coming out of the center of our pyramid, just like one of those world trees. And sometimes they show them with birds or something on them. But you'll also see people that have climbed up on there and appear to be balancing or doing other crazy stuff up there, as you can see. That must have been a pretty dang spectacular public performance, right? And of course, we actually know something about rituals like this, and there's a couple of different ceremonies that it might pertain to. One of them is called the volador, in which people essentially tie themselves with ropes to the top of the thing and jump off. It's pretty impressive. And then there are others, however, that are associated with an agricultural harvest, and in which people climb up to the top and grab some items off the top of the pole. Now, these examples here about 2,000 years ago are actually the earliest representations of either of those ceremonies in Mesoamerica, to my knowledge. Now, take a look at these two figures here, though. These are two hollow ceramic figures, some of the more incredible ones that have ever been found, actually. And you'll see that we have a male over here, we have a female over here, and there's lots of details that we could talk about, but just focus on what it is that they're holding. So if you take the figure of the male here, he has this vertical staff, and he has this little disc on top, and here it is blown up for you. And you see a little disc, and it has what on it? 1, 2, 3, 4 equally spaced little nubbins around the top of it, and then a central one that's bigger. Well, that's a model of the architecture, which is a model of the cosmos, right? So this is much like Queen Elizabeth holding an orb. It's making reference to her domain, right? The area over which she has authority. And it corresponds quite nicely to what these models of the circular architecture look like at their most elaborate. But let's take a look at the lady over here on the right. In some ways, she's more interesting. She has what looks like a fan. And, you know, decades gone by, people studying these figures would say, ah, yes, of course, it's a lady. She has to have a fan for her, right? That was sort of the obvious interpretation. Except if you look at this, it looks a heck of a lot like the objects that these figures are holding once they've climbed up to the top of the pole. So what we may have here, just like this object makes reference to these models that have more lots of activity going on, lots of people, and show these activities in context, the same thing with a fan. We may be looking at a female that these climbers up here publicly performing an agricultural ritual that would have been an important aspect of rulers' duties to the community. And this may be a lady that's doing this here. There's lots of interesting gender issues going on in West Mexico. We have what look like female players of the West Mexican ball game and some of the very earliest figures. And the very fact that you even have a theme like a male-female pair in West Mexico, that's very different than what you see elsewhere in ancient Mexico. Now, there are other forms of performance. There is the ball game I just mentioned. We have here a real ball court, an exceptionally large one, actually, and that has been excavated and restored so that you can see it. All of you should go to Teotitlan, Jalisco at your next opportunity. And then next to it, we have a model like one that's actually in the exhibit that actually shows one of these games in play, right? You have an audience up here, and you have people playing the game out here. But much like the last example I just gave you, there are hollow figures that show a specific individual who is a ball player. This one was in fact excavated by one of our speakers here, Lorenza Lopez. So we have, it was found in an elite tomb, and again, sort of points to this idea that elites specifically, not, you know, anybody, but specifically the political elite, engaged in some of these games, which can be quite risky acts, actually. But we see this elsewhere in ancient Mexico and Central America as well, where it looks like elites, rulers themselves participated in these games. Now, with this kind of background, I'd like to take us back to our topic of performance. Now, political artwork, when we think about it elsewhere in Mexico and Central America, we think about sculptures, we think about architectural embellishments, and all these other kinds of things. And their one characteristic is they tend to be very fixed. They create a place where activity takes place. In West Mexico, this art, which I would consider, much of it anyway, I would consider political artwork, with all kinds of symbols and meanings and associations with it. It's portable. That is the characteristic of West Mexican political art. That means, unlike in other areas of the broader region, these pieces can be taken out, they can be used, they can be moved around, and they can be put away again to store it for another occasion. So just take the exercise here of looking at that central figure. He looks innocuous enough, just having a drink, but he has some trophy heads on his hips. And this kind of figure is a warrior. And go ahead and imagine the different kinds of stories that you could make up by different combinations of these figures, right? You sit them out and juxtapose them in storytelling. So you have a female over here, you have a house, a location over here, you have another warrior who's tied up as a prisoner, and down here, of course, you have a nice, tasty little puppy. Now, the fact that you can move them around, juxtapose them like this, create scenes, well, that's exactly what museum exhibitors do today, isn't it? They bring these pieces out, they create their own stories or try to tell a story by specific juxtapositions of some of these figures. So, although these figures and models have been called mortuary art for decades, there is often only a limited basis for actually making that argument. We are very dependent upon pieces that have been illegally looted And where do you go when you want to find a hollow figure to sell? Well, you go to the tombs. But of course, as archaeologists, we recognize that not everything ends up in the location where it was used. Some things are found, sometimes we can better find out where they were originally used by looking at the pieces, finding broken examples. So in my excavations at the site of Navajas, for example, we've recovered figure fragments from a number of these different kinds of figures. Here we have a couple, pretty clearly a couple of eyes, right? They're actually from different pieces found in different locations. This is not a mouth, don't be fooled. That's actually a neck just turned on its side. And we have other parts, flat parts of the body here. This is the edge of an incense burner, which has little spikes around it, but they're usually sitting on the back of a critter of some kind. And then in another example, it was excavated by colleagues of ours. This does not look terribly impressive, and that's good because that means looters don't wander off with it and sell it somewhere. We find it instead, we find the pieces, and as it turns out, this was a nearly complete figure that was set up in a household area. It wasn't found standing up, of course. It was found all broken, sitting down by one of the houses. But you can see that this is actually the arm of one of these kinds of figures. In fact, it's so big I could almost overlay, put it over my own arm, and it would be very similar scale. So a lot of these pieces, then, are being used and broken and discarded long before anything ever ended up in a tomb. So the pieces that end up in the tomb are they're just a subset of the total universe of these things, probably selected from the figures that they had on hand and were appropriate to the particular burial. So I'd like to give you a more concrete idea of how I suggest the figures were used by comparing them to another medium of political art in ancient Mexico, namely the Mixtec screenfold codices, or books from southern Mexico. According to early ethnohistoric accounts, these codices were actually publicly displayed, much like you see here. They were laid out and they have all these little stories on them, and then you have someone who would actually recite their contents. One of the people who has worked the most on this is actually John Pohl, who's one of our speakers today. So I'm kind of putting myself on the spot here. John's probably going to have something to say about my ideas here. Now, I did not choose the Mixtec codices because I see any particular connection between people in West Mexico and people in Oaxaca, especially when they're separated by about 1,000+ years. But I picked them because, as an example of Mesoamerican political art, they're a pretty complete collection of the kinds of topics that are covered in Mesoamerican political art. So I thought I could get a little more of a representation here. So events covered in some of these Mixtec screenfold books include, for example, the origin of elites being born from a sacred tree, which should immediately bring to mind the emergence, the depiction of these sacred trees in the center of the architecture. It may not just be making that reference to the cosmos in a sort of static way, but it may be actually part of a broader story that is being told using these models. A major preoccupation in Mesoamerican political art is to establish the genealogy of political elites. So-and-so were their parents, and their parents going back, of course, to gods or something like that. And so parentage or kinship is depicted in a number of different ways in the Mixtec codices, for example, by tying together two figures, by a trace of footprints. Down here, we have a little more of a graphic depiction of birth taking place. And in this one, we actually have a trailing umbilical cord, I believe, behind this figure. And that should make us re-examine West Mexican figures that have often been referred to as simply, ah, how nice, a mother with child. Well, but these are quite capable of being used in narrative storytelling to tell much the same kind of stories we're seeing in Mixtec codices and elsewhere. Marriage, that's a popular theme. And we do see, of course, in West Mexico, all these male-female pairs, sometimes as a joint, a single piece, sometimes two pieces that are decorated very, very similarly. And they're being shown in the case of the Mixtec codices. In each case, it's actually in an architectural setting. Here's a ball court, and here's a building. We have cases in West Mexican art where we seem to have a kind of self-sacrifice, like a kind of bloodletting, we think. It may have different associations, but the meanings to it. But here, for example, we have some people who have pierced their cheeks with a long pole, and you can see the remnants, the marks left by these on this detailed figure. And then here's what happens when you get older after having something like that done to your cheeks. But these kinds of physical ordeals, piercing in particular, are often associated with taking on a new rank, a new kind of political position in ancient Mexico. Playing the ritual ball game. This may not just be a bunch of neighborhood kids playing the ball game for fun, but rather it has a meaning to it. It's, let's say, as we have up here, you actually have, again, a game to being taking place here, I think, on the occasion of the assumption of political rank. How do you depict rulership? Elsewhere in Mesoamerica, it's typically by taking a seat on a throne, maybe sitting on a mat, which has certain kinds of symbolic associations with it. Whereas in West Mexico, we have people being carried around in a litter, but a frequent one that only seems to show up in the higher status tombs is actually people seated on seats. So another example of what a colleague of ours used to call the simplicity complex, where you look at West Mexican art, the scene right here, for example, of a house, a couple people sitting in front. Here's actually a map of it from above, if that helps you to visualize the little people and their relationship to one another. But this for decades has been referred to as a quaint little domestic scene. Right, people sitting around with a dog, a little bowl of fruit or something like that. Except no one would really ever claim that about similar depictions in the Mixtec codices, where you have conferences taking place between elites, and guess where it's taking place? In an architectural setting. And then a common pattern is depictions of gods, or more correctly, god impersonators. Elites would often represent themselves as gods and put on little masks, represent like this figure has done here. So we have a number of examples here. I could actually continue for a while. This is a favorite topic of mine, but I'll try and spare you. But battles, taking captives, and of course, at the end of the whole thing, the issue of death and burial. These are all themes that appear in West Mexican art as well as what we see in these other forms of political art elsewhere. So, and these events are what my colleague John Pohl over here has referred to as crisis events. There are moments when the social and political order there's an upheaval. A ruler has died, uh-oh, what's gonna happen? Is this gonna be Game of Thrones, or is this gonna go neatly? What's gonna happen next, right? And so the realignment of all these social relationships is very much the theme here, I think. So, similar to reading narratives from the codices before an audience, I think storytellers could have used the figures in much the same way, to relate the exploits of gods, of culture heroes, of ancestors, living members of the elite, people who are still around to enjoy stories being told about them, or simply the person being buried. The events being depicted in the figures correspond to these in the codices in many ways, and provide insight then into the local political and social system. Storytelling itself was a political act used to support a political system as well. Thank you very much.
And a great introduction to what we're going to be talking about and really what the whole West Mexico exhibit is about, and also a terrific segue to Professor John Pohl from UCLA Department of Art History. And John has been here before and has done some research on collections at the Gilcrease, so we will be very anxious to see what he has to say.
Okay. Thank you very much. I want to thank Bob Pickering and Chris Beekman for getting me involved in this. It's a very impressive exhibition. I've done a number of exhibitions myself, but I think this is a real qualified success here. It's very well done. I'm very impressed. So thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to come back to Tulsa. I love Tulsa's downtown architecture. I love the Gilcrease, so this is a great opportunity for me. Well, as long as we're waiting just a second. You have some very important pieces here that were acquired in the 1940s. They were produced by Aztec, or we refer to them more as the Eastern Nahua branch of the Aztecs from the Plain of Puebla to Oaxaca. And they're very unique pieces. They, just as Chris was talking about, they tell stories. They tell stories from the codices themselves. But very few, they'd never been published really before, so I got very intrigued by some of the things you had here. I came here in 2006 and had the opportunity to study them and photograph them and then to produce rollout paintings of them so that we could really see what the story was. Then I did actually publish an article in Gilcrease Museum magazine, you might remember that. I think it was around 2010. Oh, yeah, this is mine here. Yeah, great. Okay, wonderful. Thank you very much. Okay, so I'm dealing with a later period. There are some very dramatic changes that happen in West Mexico. Chris and the other speakers are going to be talking about an earlier pre-classic to early classic period of time. We're not exactly sure what's happening in a transitional period, but by the outset of what we call the post-classic or the Toltec period, at about 900 to 1000 AD, we see what is apparently, and I've just been making my first trips to West Mexico now myself, I'm a Oaxaca specialist, but we see a sudden explosion of construction activity and possibly a large population increase and dramatic evidence of West Mexico's engagement with other civilizations in Mesoamerica, particularly along the Pacific coast. And not only Mesoamerica, but also northern Mexico and the American Southwest. West Mexico becomes directly engaged with the movement of a lot of important materials, such as turquoise. Much of the turquoise that is being used in Mesoamerica actually has its sources here in Arizona, California, New Mexico, and northern Mexico. So this is a very dramatic, there are many dramatic changes. And as you can see, and this is what interests me, on this plate, this is an image, a bowl from the site of a mapa. It dates to about 1350 and it portrays the face of a god who is the god of the morning star. His name was Tlawis Kalpan Tekutli in the Nahua language. He has a name in the Kora language of the Kora Indian people of Nayarit today. I didn't write it down. I'm just getting into this material now. We generally identify him, though, as Tlawis Kalpan Tekutli. Now, just to kind of introduce you to this post-classic period, you all know it as the Aztec period. The nation of Mexico, in constructing a national identity, embraced the Aztec Empire as its direct, as the Mexican people are the direct inheritor of this great civilization created by the Aztec. It was particularly under the President Porfirio Diaz that we see an explosion of interest in using Aztec as a national identity, and rightfully so. Subsequent excavations in downtown Mexico City show us the existence of some very impressive architecture, the Temple of Mayor, for example, seen here in a reconstruction painting. The excavator, Eduardo Matos, thinks this structure was nearly 15 stories high. And all of this wealth, of course, is what we study from this particular period of time, from about 1400 to the time of the conquest, was achieved as a military empire. This is a warrior society that creates a very powerful army and begins to attack, particularly in southern Mexico, extract a lot of wealth by conquest, and the wealth is then pumped back into the city as tribute and redistributed to produce the kinds of monumental art and architecture that we see. So at the time of the conquest, this is the extent of the Aztec expansion throughout much of Mexico. Now, they haven't gotten into West Mexico directly, but they are expanding down into the Gulf, down under the Pacific coast, especially here in Guerrero with Acapulco. There were some independent areas, Tlaxcala, of course, which provided Cortes with his first army for his first initial military campaign, and they were Eastern Nahuas or Eastern Aztecs, and then the Mixtec and Zapotec capitals on the coast of Tututepec and Tehuantepec. Now, much of that area that you see that is conquered by the Aztec Empire is actually occupied by up to anywhere between 15 and 20 different language groups. The predominant groups are the Mixtecs, which you see in number one on the map, and the Zapotecs, which you see at number two on the map. These peoples developed this international style. This is what we call the Mixteca Puebla style. I prefer Nahua Mixteca style because it refers to the people themselves, not the cultures. And also the international style. It's a very cartoon-like style. You saw how much of an investment was made into some sophisticated writing systems in earlier periods of time. The Maya writing system, for example, or there are the Zapotec writing system from Montalban. All of that is actually, that disappears. These 12 to 15, even 20 different language groups all invest now in an international communication system. It's a very unique period of time. It actually is very effective because it empowers people of different ethnic backgrounds to create an elite identity and an elite communication system that they can apply to themselves in much the same way as we use media today. Look at your computer, for example. I've got a dog that is my search engine. I've got a talking paperclip. I mean, we're actually using these kind of pictographs all the time in our own digital technologies. Now, most of there were no empires or even very large cities in southern Mexico at the time. At this time, this is from about 1350 to time of the conquest, or even they continued on later all the way up into 1600, because many of these kingdoms bonded with the Dominicans and the Franciscans and continued as powerful Indian states in the early colonial period. These are city-states. There are no empires in southern Mexico. This is what the Aztecs are taking on. They're trying to break up these confederations of city-states, which are largely formulated by intermarriages, and then to extract the wealth that is coming out of these city-states. So this is a portrayal of a royal woman in her palace, for example, in the Mixteca Alta, a reconstruction of the Temple of Heaven at a Mixtec kingdom. These marriages then, actually the marriages are coordinated through a central urban area, a large archaeological zone that you know as a contemporary city of Cholula. Here's Cholula here. And Cholula is functioning as a pilgrimage and market center. It is not a military capital as Tenochtitlan, located about 2 hours just to the northwest of Cholula by driving there. So Cholula is actually providing the ideology of centralization. This is where you go to become indoctrinated into the system and to then inherit or be given your rights and titles to rule your city-states. The Spaniards compared Cholula to being like a Vatican in the 16th century, for example. Any of you who watched the program The Borgias know what kind of politics is going on between a pope and all of those Italian and Spanish city-states at this time. That's exactly how the Spaniards are envisioning this system is working when they describe it. Now, Cholula had a cult temple as well. The cult temple was dedicated to a Toltec hero. His name was Quetzalcoatl, or the plumed serpent. Here's an image of Quetzalcoatl from Codex Borgia. We are very fortunate in that we have a number of codices. Chris showed you Codex Nuttall already, that document heroic stories and creation legends that are the foundation for the rights to rule by these royal families that are engaged in these constellations of marriages that override the ethnicities of these 12 or 15 different language groups. Now, the critical theme that we see, the statement of royal marriage that we can see in the codex, actually always features a drinking vessel. And so here's a typical Mixtec drinking vessel with, it's a tripod with three legs. The legs end in serpents. And here's a drawing, an interpretation of exactly that same drinking vessel with the serpent legs and a frothy sort of head of chocolate on top of the bowl. The term chocolate in the Mixtec language actually refers to dowry in marriage in many of the terms for chocolate that appear in colonial dictionaries. The Gilcrease is very fortunate, and you have a number of these works in your collections. They've never even been restored, which makes them extraordinarily valuable. In fact, residue analysis can probably be done on these as well to test for chocolate, to see if chocolate actually is still contained in these. This is a beautiful piece that has medallions that feature serpent heads on them. It's done in a burnished black slip with orange or kind of a reddish slip paint. And then it has an ornamentation of white flowers, which are generally taken to be datura, which is natural LSD, and a number of other more ornamental features. Most recently has been an excavation in the Mixteca Alta of a palace at a town called Tepozcalula. This was directed by Nellie Robles of the National Institute of Anthropology and History and Ronald Spores, Professor Emeritus of Vanderbilt University. And these turn out to be fragments of these blackware vessels with these orange medallions with images on them. So you can see that there. So this piece may very well come from Tepozcalula. Here's another piece in the Gilcrease collections, and you can see that it has the images of a number of nobles painted around the sides of this picture. I came to the Gilcrease in 2006 and did a lot of detailed photography and then reconstructed a kind of a rollout of what the scene actually portrays. And then to my amazement, it actually identified a very famous event in which a Mixtec king named Eight Deer and his aide, his assistant, Lord Five Rain, have an encounter with a sun god who miraculously appears in a tree. This was a very dramatic event in Eight Deer's life. Eight Deer is a kind of an Achilles or a or even a Richard III or a Macbeth in Mixtec creation story histories. Now, one of the things that I've been able to do in the, with the codices is show that they're more than just simply records of families and descent. They actually illustrate the construction of alliance corridors. So in this case, Codex Nuttall doesn't just document Aedir's family, it documents how his descendants were able to intermarry with two other powerful kingdoms, Tezcatlipoca and ultimately the Zapotec kingdom of Xochila, to become the ranking, sort of the title of a kind of a House of Windsor that was dominating political affairs in Oaxaca at the time, in the 1500s at the time the Spaniards arrived. So that's where you, that's how I'm able to reconstruct these marriage alliances. Now, the fascinating thing about this is that the distribution, remember the symbol for marriage, you know, these ceramic vessels, so the symbol for the distribution of that ceramic material should give us some kind of indication as to whether this marriage alliance system is something that I've either invented or it actually existed. And so using research of a number of chemical research from several scientists, we find that the distribution of the polychrome ceramics matches this distribution of these marriage alliances, this constellation of marriage alliances. So this is archaeological proof that what we're getting from the documents actually existed as a real concept of political alliance through intermarriage in southern Mexico. Now, the Mixtecs in particular, and the Zapotecs, were renowned for their execution in small portable works of art, especially in weaving, which you're still familiar with today, is a major part of the traditions in Oaxaca today. Turquoise, now, we know that a mask like this, which is preserved in the British Museum, could have over 20,000 individual pieces of tessera or turquoise that are worked into this mask. Imagine what it's like to even shape these things. Some of them are only 2 to 5 millimeters in width. We have some recent research in which we know that that mask in particular was presented by the founder of the Dominican Order in Oaxaca to Pope Clement VII, and it was explained that these masks were used to talk to the dead. In other words, they were placed over mummies, and then one could actually access, or it was believed, talk to the spirit of a deceased ancestor through these masks. Now, gold was also introduced at this time. Metallurgy is introduced to West Mexico in this earlier period, probably back by maybe 850, 900 AD. It's a technology that's coming into West Mexico from Central America. And then, of course, tropical bird feathers. And what I've been proposing then is that these constellations of marriages are not just about accrued power, in other words, inherited power, but real power in terms of control over the arts. So we know we have documents that and statements that a lot of these works of art were traded in dowry and bride wealth systems. So a ruler who could marry as maybe as many as 20 or 30 times, and he's not in love with all of these people, this is just simply how he's building actually a very powerful artistic force in his palace. Most of the women are becoming the economic engine for this gift award system. His first wife will be the mother of the heir to the throne, but his second wife might be a top embroiderer. Her son, in turn, may become the merchant. Her second son might become the primary jeweler, producing jewels that are then exchanged in a bride wealth system for a third wife, who might be a painter, for example. Now, this kind of system would have a greater draw and fascination on the exotic. The more exquisite your materials that you're producing, the rarer the materials are, the longer distances they come from, is going to put a lot of competition into these royal houses to come up with better and better, rarer and rarer materials, and more highly crafted art to acquire, to invest in these marriage alliance systems. And this is what's producing the acquisition of this art, from spondylus shell here all the way down in Ecuador to turquoise coming out of the American Southwest. It's all being pumped into West Mexico and ultimately Oaxaca here. Now, the curious thing about this is that there is, I talked about how the marriage alliance system can be seen in the ceramics itself, but a curious thing that happens is that in West Mexico, between probably about 1200 to 1350, 1400, we have a manifestation of exactly the same international style and polychrome system. This is a writing system, and it's done in painted vessels. Now, from my perspective, this, we don't have to say anything more. It's very obvious to me that these people are intermarrying with these people, even though they're located 1,000 miles up the coast. Now, the vessels are exquisitely painted and very, very detailed. They would probably, at this point, we can probably be talking about people who are directly ancestral to the Cora and Huichol people of Nayarit. Now, a pioneer in the study of these was a Los Angeles resident, but originally trained in Mexico. I believe he was German. He may have been Austrian originally. It was Hasso von Winning. And Hasso von Winning was a consultant to Gilcrease. He was a consultant to the Stendhal Gallery in Los Angeles that provided many of the pieces to the Gilcrease collection. And he had the opportunity to sit down and actually draw out a number of these vases when they came into Los Angeles in the 1960s. And these are some of his drawings, his initial sketches. I'm using these as the basis to create rollout paintings of these. Now, the one that interests me the most at first here is this very curious birth ritual. Chris showed you an image of this as well. It's a woman giving birth to this very odd character coming out between her legs. She's attended by midwives. And then there's an individual here with a staff. Another individual is kind of covering his face. There's another individual covering his face here. And then the presentation of this very odd character by the midwives in front of, or perhaps on top of, some kind of a textile. Now, we see that same scene here in Codex Nuttall. And what strikes me, and this is why I'm connecting so much of this imagery from West Mexico to the Mixtec specifically, because there's so many details that are obvious. I think you can see a comparison here, that even the woman who's giving birth, you have to turn your head sideways a little bit to see the little guy coming out. But she even has a plumed serpent rising up over her body in exactly the same way that it's appearing here with Lady Three Flint, who's giving birth to her daughter. This cannot be coincidental. This is to us who work with this as a writing system, this is direct evidence of people who are in contact, direct contact with each other. This is the little figure himself. He's kind of dwarf-like, and he has a fanged tooth with these kind of bumps on his head. Now, that would be very peculiar and hard to understand from a West Mexican perspective alone, but, and here's my drawings of him, but in reality, he's very famous to us in Oaxaca. He's a very specific type of deity that we call a nu'u, Mixtec's atonal language. The nu'u, as you can see, is actually a manifestation of the earth. It's an anthropomorphic spirit. Here it is as involved with the birth of maize. Here it is as actually directing the rain to fall. Here's a little wooden nu'u that's giving birth to a little lord here, and yet he also has genitalia underneath him. So it has a kind of a bisexual earth in a sense. You can see the little bumps or horns on his head, which are a reference to the fact that he's made of stone or a hill or the earth itself. When we look at a second vase here, we have a very complex scene that's now in the Los Angeles County Museum of Art. This scene interests me a great deal because it portrays an individual, perhaps a little maize god, who's being attended by two women who pour water over him in a purification ceremony as two rain gods fly overhead. Now compare that then to this scene of a marriage. In Codex Nuttall, we see the two women pouring bowls of water over the marriage couple in much the same way, in a purification ritual. Here we see another purification ritual in which a Lord Eight Wind has a flying rain god over him who's blessing him with a pitcher of water. These rituals are directly related to purification rituals, especially at the birth of royal children. And so we still have records of this as being a purification ritual associated with Kora Metote dances and Kora rites. It's related in the accounts of Friar Bernardino de Sahagun upon the naming of a child, and then the fact that we can coordinate or correlate these scenes so closely between what are painted on the vases and scenes we see in the Mixtec codices is really remarkable. Now, here is another type of ceramic, and I was very interested to see that one of these is in the exhibition. It's a kind of a tanware, and the one that you have in the exhibition is a bowl with a plume serpent on it, a Quetzalcoatl serpent on it. It sometimes has some red decoration. This is one that turned up recently, and because this material is so little known, we're discovering it in the oddest places. A colleague said that from State University of New York, Buffalo, said that a man came in and had bought this at a gun show and brought this in and showed it to her. And on closer examination, the fine line work that is on it depicts a very important scene that has to do with the time when the sun was created, when the sun appeared for the first time to illuminate the world. Imagine that turning up at a gun show. The piece has since gone into the collections at the State University. Now, it's very close in conception to a ritual of the creation of the first sun in the Mixtec Codex Vienna. I think you can see the little deity seated inside of the sun disk. In this case, the sun was created together with other false suns, and these suns were not successful and fell back over the horizon line of the earth, but the true sun finally rose through an act of through a cascade of blood and finally rose into the sky. Here's the image as it actually appears in Codex Vienna. Vienna is very detailed in telling us how this event took place. All of the gods came together, including Quetzalcoatl. They had a mushroom ceremony, an hallucinogenic mushroom ceremony, and through this, together with a drinking ceremony, called forth by singing, they sung to the sun and entreated the sun to appear on the earth for the first time. Now, we can correlate. This is where the importance of these vases from West Mexico will become clear. The Mixtec codices, we can read these and correlate them with specific ruins. Look at this little ruin on top of this mountain in the Achiutla Valley in the Mixtec Alta. This mountain is still called Hill of the Sun today. And the legends are still told by Mixtec people that this is where the sun was first created. There are other indicators of hieroglyphic place signs that tell us that it's linked specifically with this archaeological site. Now that's important because it implies then, this is all just getting started, this is a whole new field, but it implies that we can start to associate many of these peregrinations and rituals of the Huichol with specific locations, such as their place where the sun rose for the first time. Okay, well that's the potential in a lot of this. Am I running out of time? Yeah. So I'll just show you something very quickly here. There's the potential for understanding another set, another manifestation of the ceramic, which are these stucco figurines. They have gold relief on them, which suggests they may be connected to even some of these masks. They can be put together to tell stories too, which is what Chris was suggesting. And we can put them into correlations with the codices. Here's one that just turned up. I saw this last summer. It's a marriage. A marriage on a stucco platform, but it's a marriage, as we see here. But we can associate these with real places, or at least the concept of real places, such as a royal house that can be identified archaeologically. So this is just sort of a brief introduction of what the potential is in looking at these vases and extracting an entire society, an understanding of the society from this kind of analysis. Thank you very much for inviting me.
Thank you, John. Amazing. We're going to have the third presentation, so if we could have that put up. And now I'd like to introduce Marco Zavaleta, who's the archaeologist at the National Institute of Anthropology and History Regional Center in Sonora, Mexico. And Professor Bruce Willis is going to be the translator. So we'll see how all this goes.
Buenas tardes. Yo voy a hablar un poco sobre lo que son los trabajos arqueológicos que se están realizando en la ciudad de Colima. Mi ponencia se titula Dos contextos funerarios en Colima, el caso de salvamento arqueológico parcelas 12-19-25 y el salvamento arqueológico Mina de Peña.
Good afternoon, I'm going to speak about archaeological salvage in the state of Colima.
En los últimos años, la zona conurbada Colima-Villa de Álvarez en el estado de Colima ha sufrido un importante y acelerado desarrollo en cuanto a infraestructura de vivienda se refiere, por lo que el crecimiento urbano de la ciudad está planificado y se tiene proyectado hasta el año 2030. Desde esta perspectiva y tomando en cuenta que algunos de los terrenos contemplados en dicho plan de desarrollo pueden contener evidencia de actividad humana de épocas pasadas, se integra una política de conservación en la que se refiere a aquellas zonas que contienen elementos patrimoniales que por su importancia cultural, histórica o monumental es necesario preservar.
Lately, the urban area of Villa de Álvarez in the state of Colima has been undergoing a lot of urbanization. They have a plan set up for the next few years, and the idea is to conserve sites of archaeological importance.
Conserving sites of archaeological importance in the state of Colima.
Ante esta problemática, el Instituto de Antropología e Historia busca las estrategias adecuadas para aplicar la ley federal sobre monumentos y zonas arqueológicas, artísticas e históricas. Es en este tenor que surgen estos dos salvamentos arqueológicos.
So the National Institute of Anthropology and History in Mexico is looking for ways to apply the federal law to preserve monuments in archaeological areas, and that's how this project has come about.
El salvamento arqueológico parcelas 12-19-25 se desarrolló hacia el oeste de lo que es la ciudad de Colima. Este es el estado de Colima que se ubica hacia el occidente de México. Esta es la parcela 12-19 y esta es la parcela 25. Desafortunadamente, la parcela 25 no se pudo intervenir por problemas de tenencia de la tierra.
So we're looking at three parcels of land in Colima State in West Mexico. They are to the east of the city of Colima. Unfortunately, parcel 25 there in the south was not able to be included because of land ownership issues.
Las parcelas se caracterizan por tener un terreno inclinado que va de norte hacia sur y hacia sus costados, tanto izquierdo como derecho, corren dos arroyos, lo cual, en palabras del arqueólogo Saúl Alcántara, colocan al sitio dentro de una zona preferencial para el establecimiento de grupos humanos.
The land is on a slope going from north to south, and it has creeks running along the sides, which puts it in a makes it a preferential land area.
La evidencia arqueológica que se detectó en estas parcelas consistió en evidencia cerámica, alineamientos de piedra. Aquí tenemos otro grupo de elementos de piedra. El terreno estaba cubierto por vegetación de matorral y árboles para el cultivo de tamarindo.
The land was covered with scrub vegetation and tamarind trees, but once that was cleared, they were able to find ceramic evidence and also stone evidence.
En cuanto a la metodología que se sigue para el estudio de estos sitios, primero se realiza el recorrido de superficie detectando las zonas donde se encuentra la evidencia arqueológica. Posteriormente se hacen trazos de pozo de sondeo que son de 2 metros por 1, y dependiendo de la evidencia, se deciden ampliar a unidades de excavaciones más amplias.
So the methodology for excavation was to go over the landscape and look at the details, and then to produce boreholes, which are 2 meters deep by 1 meter wide, and then make a decision that any sites that need to be made wider or increased.
En este caso, la evidencia arqueológica que se detectó fue un área funeraria encontrada en el noreste de la parcela 19.
In the northeast of parcel 19, what was found was a funerary deposit.
Fue un área que abarcaba 258 metros cuadrados, en donde para su exploración se trazó una retícula de 24 metros de norte a sur por 22 metros de este a oeste.
The site measurements were just given to me.
Dentro de la evidencia arqueológica que se detectó en esta zona, encontramos un grupo de ofrendas. Estas ofrendas no estaban relacionadas directamente con entierros, por lo que se trabajaron independientemente. La ofrenda 1 está integrada por una vasija de fondo curvo y dos manos de metate de aproximadamente 25 centímetros.
The first offering has a bowl and two, they're called manos de metate, they are what's used to grind grain or seeds on a ceramic bottom.
La segunda ofrenda estaba constituida por tres conjuntos de piezas. La primera, una vasija reclinatorio en forma de ave. Esta tiene las alas extendidas y las plumas de la cola las tiene extendidas, que son lo que es la base. Hacia la parte de atrás presenta dos piernas, lo que le proporciona la estabilidad. Una vasija trípode y fragmentos de lo que se conoce como incensario tipo canasta. En este caso se trata de un fragmento de la figura de una tortuga.
So the three pieces, the first one looks like a bird. It's in a reclining bird that is resting on its tail feathers and has the wings out to the side. The second piece is a tripod bowl. And the third is a collection of fragments from, I believe it's called a basket style, is that right? Canasta? Basket style.
La segunda pieza que integra esta ofrenda se trata de una vasija cuya característica es que la tapadera tiene forma de perro. Y lo principal de esta tapadera es que es un silbato. Y el sonido se sopla por el hocico del perro y el sonido sale en la parte de abajo.
So this is a very interesting pot, that the lid has a dog. The dog is also a whistle, and you blow into the whistle through the dog's mouth and the sound comes out at the dog's throat.
El tercer elemento que integra esta ofrenda es un conjunto de flautas, así como un fragmento de otro incensario tipo canasta. Este incensario presenta dos caras opuestas, un joven y un viejo.
So the third element of this site are a group of flutes and also more incensarios, which have the same basket form from the earlier one.
La ofrenda 3 está integrada por una vasija globular de color rojo, mientras que la ofrenda 4 es una vasija de silueta compuesta del mismo color rojo.
Both offerings 3 and 4 have vessels with a typical red color.
La ofrenda 5 es un poco más interesante, puesto que se trata de un conjunto de varias piezas. La primera es una vasija en forma de cabeza humana, la cual tiene como característica principal una especie de yelmo que se identificó como forma de pez globo, pues estas pequeñas protuberancias que salen aquí, vista de planta, representan aletas.
The fifth offering is much more interesting. It has a variety of objects, the first of which is this human head, which is wearing a helmet that is in the form of a blowfish. Those fishes that puff up, and it looks like the part that you can see sticking out there would be a fin.
La segunda pieza es una vasija de forma rectangular, la cual fue reutilizada, puesto que hay algunas que en esta parte presentan dos pequeñas aves, y en este caso fueron eliminadas.
This is a rectangular vessel that had some kind of ceremonial use. It used to have two birds on top of the lid, one on each side, but they have been removed.
La tercera pieza que integra esta ofrenda es una urna funeraria que está integrada por un personaje que está sentado en cuyas piernas sostiene una vasija.
So the third piece is a funerary urn, a seated person who is holding the urn in his lap.
Lo característico de esta pieza fue que en la excavación se encontró sin cabeza y sin un brazo. Ya al momento de estarla restaurando en el museo, se halló que la cabeza y el brazo faltante se encontraban dentro del recipiente que está cargando.
When they found the piece, it was missing a head and his head and an arm. And it was only in the act of taking it back to the museum, starting to put it together, they found the head and the arm in the urn that it is holding.
La ofrenda 6 corresponde a una vasija, la cual presenta incisiones en líneas paralelas que corren en todo su cuerpo.
The sixth offering is a vessel that has incisions, parallel incisions, going all around the side.
Mientras que la ofrenda 6 se trata de dos astas de venado, las cuales se colocaron directamente en la tierra y están muy deterioradas. Perdón, la ofrenda 7.
While the seventh, the offering number 7 has two deer antlers placed in the ground in the positions that you see.
Okay. Estas son algunas de las características que se hallaron con los entierros. Estos entierros, algunos presentaban una tapadera o una cubierta de piedras, como en la primera foto. Estas piedras podían estar acompañadas con metates y con manos de metate, cubriendo todo lo que es el cuerpo.
One of the characteristics of these burials is that there is often a layer of stone, and the stone is often found with these metates, or grinding stones, and the mano, that is like a rolling pin that's used with the grinding stone.
Okay. Los entierros se fueron localizados entre la segunda y la tercera capa estratigráfica. En total, en esta unidad se excavaron 30 entierros.
There were 30 burials found between the second and third stratigraphic layers.
Con respecto a la forma en que fueron depositados los restos humanos, se observó que en algunos fue de manera directa, es decir, colocaron el cuerpo sobre el suelo, y en la gran mayoría fue de manera indirecta, puesto que algunos fueron sepultados en fosas excavadas en el Tepetate.
Well, the majority of these burials were direct burials, where the body was just laid out. In others, the body was put into a like a covering, right? Like a rolled up covering. Like a rolled-up mat.
De los sistemas funerarios excavados, 23 son individuales y 7 son múltiples, en los cuales se localizaron más de 2 individuos, como es el caso del entierro 13.
Of the 35 burials, 26 were individual, 7 were collective, sometimes more than, as in burial number 13.
En este caso, parte de este entierro fue removido para colocar otro cuerpo. Aquí se detectaron alrededor de 8 individuos.
It seems that part of one individual had been removed to fit more bodies, and parts of 8 individuals were found.
Los cuerpos se encontraron principalmente en posición primaria, es decir, en posición anatómica. Se tienen también entierros que fueron removidos por acción de saqueo, en los cuales no es factible identificar la posición o movimiento que tuvieron los cuerpos.
Most of them are found in anatomical position, laid out as a skeleton, but sometimes because of tomb raiders, it's impossible to know what position they were in originally.
Uno de los hallazgos más importantes en esta unidad habitacional, perdón, en funeraria, fue el hallazgo de una tumba de tiro sellada.
One of the most important finds was a shaft tomb that had been sealed.
Aquí vemos el sello que presenta la tumba. Es una especie de mezcla de arena y barro en la cual sobresalen dos manos de metate.
This is the seal that was placed over the tomb. It's a mix of sand and clay, and you can also see two of the rolling pin-like manos up at the top.
Posteriormente que se retiró esta mezcla, se hallaron dos metates cubriendo lo que es la entrada y este que es el escalón de acceso hacia lo que sería posteriormente la cámara funeraria.
The next level down shows the two metates, which are the larger rectangular pieces, and you can see the first step down into the tomb.
Aquí podemos apreciar de forma más clara lo que es el escalón y el relleno de piedras que tenía el tiro.
Here you can see better the first step down and how the space has been filled up with stones.
Esta ya es la entrada a lo que es la cámara funeraria. Aquí se logran apreciar algunas piezas.
This is the opening to the funerary area and you can start to see some of the pieces.
Y esta es una vista de lo que había en el interior de la tumba.
This is the interior of the shaft tomb.
Al frente se encontraron lo que es la ofrenda compuesta por diferentes tipos de vasijas. Hacia el fondo se observan los huesos largos y unos cráneos hacia el extremo derecho.
So the front area is mostly ceramic vessels. Towards the back you can see longer bones, and then over to the right side you can see some skulls.
Los restos humanos que se encontraron en el interior de la tumba de tiro pertenecen a 36 individuos, 35 de los cuales fueron colocados de manera secundaria.
What the remains were found inside the tomb pertain to 36 individuals, 35 of whom were put in secondary position.
Hoy un individuo fue hallado en forma de posición de cúbito dorsal al que se denominó entierro principal.
One figure was found in the different position on its back. That's the principal burial.
Lo que se detectó en esta tumba fue que los huesos largos se encontraban hasta el fondo y en la primera capa de restos óseos.
What was distinct was that the long bones were found at the back and on the top of the bone pile.
Abajo de los huesos largos encontramos vértebras, costillas, huesos de pies y de manos.
So below the long bones were the vertebrae and also the ribs and the hand and foot bones.
Hacia el extremo izquierdo se encontraron huesos que pertenecen a infantes.
On the left were found bones that correspond to children.
Y abajo de lo que sería este grupo de ofrendas se encontró lo que fue el entierro principal.
Below that area that he was showing there is where the principal burial was found.
Este es el entierro principal que se localizó y esta es la foto que nos proporcionó la antropóloga física.
Here you can see what the principal burial looked like and the photo of it put together.
En el área funeraria, al exterior de la tumba, se contabilizaron 36 adultos, 20 infantes y 66 individuos que no pudieron ser identificados.
You can see the totals were 36 adults between the ages there and 20 children and 6 who were not identified.
De acuerdo al análisis, se tienen 3 individuos que pertenecen a la fase Ortices, 24 a la fase Comala, 7 individuos a la fase Armería, 10 individuos que no se pudo identificar a qué fase corresponden y 18 individuos que fueron saqueados.
So this graph shows the different phases of time in which the figures were found, 18 of which in the fifth category there where it says saqueo were that couldn't be determined because of tomb raiders messing up the site.
En lo que fue la tumba de Tiro, se contabilizaron 34 adultos con una edad que va de entre 21 y 50 años.
There were 34 adults found between the ages of 21 and 50.
Dos infantes cuya edad va de entre 5 y 6 años.
Two children between the ages of 5 and 6.
Y un adolescente cuya edad se detectó que era de 15 años.
And one adolescent approximately 15 years old.
En cuanto a la evidencia arqueológica arquitectónica presente en la parcela 19, se identificó que son alineamientos de piedra que corresponden a plataformas habitacionales.
In parcel 19, what could be determined from the placement of stones was that the stones were laid out corresponding to rooms, rooms.
El salvamento arqueológico Mina de Peña se desarrolló en un predio ubicado al poniente de la ciudad de Villa de Álvarez.
This site, Mina de Peña, is on the west side of the city of Villa de Álvarez.
El terreno en este sitio se encontraba sumamente alterado debido a la acción de emparejamiento por máquinas para la construcción de calles, así como la extracción de material para construcción, ya que es un banco de arena.
This area was compromised heavily because of the construction of a road and also because of mining for construction materials.
En este sitio, la evidencia arqueológica se detectó en un área de 4 hectáreas en donde se ubicaron 3 áreas con evidencia funeraria.
This is a 4-hectare site that had 3 sites within it that showed funerary evidence.
Es importante destacar que esta zona se caracteriza porque es tierra firme, mientras que alrededor se halla todo lo que es el banco de arena.
The site is important because it is solid ground, whereas all around it is sandy soil.
Esto es la unidad de excavación número 3, en donde aquí se recuperaron 2 entierros.
That is excavation site 3, where 2 burials were found.
Esta es la unidad de excavación número 5, en esta se recuperaron 17 entierros.
In site number 5, they found 17 burials.
Y en la unidad de excavación número 3, se recuperaron 9 entierros. Lo característico de estas áreas funerarias es que esta es exclusivamente de niños. No se encontraron adultos, mientras que aquí se encontraron adultos y niños. Y esta corresponde a adultos.
So in site number 3, there were 9 burials and exclusively children. In the first site at the left on the top, there were exclusively adults. And in the large site in the middle, there were adults and children.
Estos son los entierros de la unidad de excavación número 3. Se encontraron en lo que se denominó cista funeraria, enmarcada por piedras, para lo cual ocuparon para delimitarlos una roca que se encontraba en el sitio, aprovechándola para marcar los 2 entierros.
So these 2 burials are surrounded by or lined by these rocks, and the rocks that were found at the site were the ones that were used for this.
En la unidad de excavación 5, inicialmente se encontró un alineamiento de piedra, la cual hacía escuadra, lo que nos llevó a extenderla aún más hacia el este y hacia el oeste.
When they saw this rock formation in site number 5, they wanted to open it more on both the east and west sides.
Después de que se continuó con la excavación, pensamos que se trataba de una unidad habitacional. Sin embargo, hacia esta sección se encontraron restos infantiles, lo que nos llevó a pensar que se trataba de otra área funeraria.
At first they guessed that it was going to be the outline of a room, but when they found the remains of children outside the perimeter there, they decided that it was a child burial area.
La característica que se detectó en estos entierros de la unidad 5, algunos fueron depositados directamente en la tierra, algunos otros presentan lo que se denominan marcadores de entierro, que es la cubierta de piedras y metates, algunos simplemente presentan un pequeño alineamiento de piedras a un costado del cuerpo.
Some of the burials were put directly into the ground, other burials were covered with stones and metates, and still others are marked by a kind of a wall of stones and metates along the side of the body.
En el pequeño alineamiento de piedras que se localizó, la ofrenda hallada consistió en una figurilla de una mujer, la cual, de acuerdo a nuestras observaciones, está embarazada, una maqueta de una casa de forma circular, en el cual en el techo se puede observar que tenía la figura de un perrito, puesto que se halla en la evidencia de lo que son las patas. Esta figura de la mujer embarazada estaba dentro de la maqueta de la casa, que es esta.
What was found at this site were two separate pieces, one within the other. The figure of the pregnant woman who it was resting in the model of a house that which was, as you can see in the bottom picture, upside down. The house roof looks like it has, at one point, had a dog on the roof, because we see what is left of the dog's feet.
De igual forma, se halló una figurilla de una mujer la cual está cargando a dos infantes. Uno lo lleva en la espalda y el otro lo está cargando en los brazos.
And there's another woman who has two children on her back and a third in her arms.
Aquí está otra característica de los entierros de la unidad de excavación 8. Son infantes.
More characteristics of excavation site 8.
Lo interesante de estos infantes es que el primero se localizaron cuentas de concha.
In the first there were shell beads found.
Así como omóplatos de venado, los cuales fueron trabajados para hacer un omexicahuastli.
Also, there were these are pieces of deer bone that were modified to make a it's like a stick that has shaking parts on it.
En este espacio se detectaron restos de otros infantes, el cual este presentó un collar de colmillos. No, aún no sabemos de qué animal se trata. Y este otro entierro presentó un mineral rojo que tampoco se han realizado los estudios para saber qué mineral es.
These are child burial sites. One of them had a necklace of teeth that still have not been identified. Another one had a red mineral that still has not been identified.
Esta es la tapa que se localizó, la cual cubría la entrada a la tumba de tiro que se halló en esta unidad de excavación.
You can see to one side the covering of the three stones that was on top of the entrance to the shaft tomb there in the second picture.
Aquí podemos ver parte del relleno que cubría la entrada.
There's part of what covered the filling that covered the entrance.
Y este es el interior de la cámara funeraria.
This is the interior of the shaft tomb funerary chamber.
Se localizaron dos osarios, uno al extremo izquierdo y el otro al extremo derecho.
There were two ossuaries or bone collection sites, one at the left and one at the right, the interior.
Y la ofrenda consistió en una figura de lo que nosotros denominamos un personaje chamán, el cual lleva sostiene con su mano una especie de hacha y presenta un tocado con bandas. así como la evidencia de que portaba un cuerno en la frente.
The interesting piece there in the offering is guessed to be a shaman who is carrying an axe and whose striped hat shows that it may have had a horn on top.
Y de igual forma se detectó un entierro principal el cual presentaba posición extendida.
And the principal burial has an extended position skeleton.
En total se contabilizaron 12 adultos de 21 a 40 años, 8 infantes de 1 a 8 años, 9 adolescentes de 15 años y un individuo no identificado.
There were 12 adults between the ages of 21 and 40, 8 children between the ages of 1 and 8, 9 adolescents around 15 years old and 1 who was not identified.
De la fase Ortizes tenemos 4 entierros, de la fase Comala 3 entierros, de la fase Colima 6, de la fase Armería 4 y 3 que no se pudo identificar la temporalidad.
Of the 30 burials, you can see the breakdown here by the phases, and the last category, 3 undetermined.
Dentro de la tumba de Tiro se contabilizaron 12 individuos de 25 a 35 años, un infante cuyo edad oscila entre 5 y 6 años y 5 individuos no identificados.
Inside the shaft tomb itself, there were 12 adults between the ages of 25 and 35, one child around 5 or 6 years old, and 5 unidentified.
Para concluir, tenemos que en los 12 salvamentos encontramos ofrendas y objetos propios de la labor de las personas sepultadas, tales como punzones para hilar o pulidores de cerámica.
In conclusion, in the offerings, there were often found objects that represented the labor that the particular individuals did, such as implements for sewing or polishing.
Ambos sitios presentaron restos óseos caninos.
There were canine dog remains as well, canine bone remains.
Se notó una reutilización de los espacios funerarios.
The funeral spaces had been reutilized.
Así como una preparación tanto de los recintos funerarios como de los cuerpos.
The funeral enclosures had also been prepared as much as the bodies themselves had been prepared.
Tenemos que hay un ritual acompañado con instrumentos musicales.
There was an accompanying ritual with musical instruments.
Así como identificadores de diferenciación social.
Indicators of social differentiation.
Y arquitectura funeraria.
And also a funerary architecture.
Who get to work with museum collections, work by Marcos and his colleagues is extraordinarily important. We get to see lots of beautiful objects. We do not have context from which those objects come. Archaeologists like Marcos provide that critical link to that kind of data. To follow that up, our fourth and last speaker, Lorenza Lopez Mestas, we've known each other since the 1990s, is the chief of archaeology at the regional center of Jalisco for the Instituto Nacional de Antropología e Historia, and I am very pleased to introduce her.
Buenas tardes a todos. Primeramente quiero agradecer a Bob, a Cheryl y a todo el personal del museo por la invitación a compartir esta tarde.
Good afternoon to Bob and Cheryl and all of the workers here at Gilcrease for the invitation.
Bueno, como lo dijo Bob, desde hace más de 20 años trabajo con textos funerarios.
As Bob said, it's been 20 years that she's been working with funerary contexts.
Y mi interés principal es cómo ligar el ritual funerario, los datos que vienen de estos contextos, con un contexto social más amplio que incluya obviamente los cambios sociales y políticos que se dan en estos grupos.
My main interest is to link these findings that we have to social phenomena of the time.
Y cómo en estos rituales podemos ligar aspectos también más amplios de la cosmovisión de estos grupos y también aspectos ideológicos.
And how we can see from our findings aspects of worldview or ideology of these ancient cultures.
Mi trabajo lo he desarrollado principalmente en el centro de Jalisco, en donde desde el preclásico encontramos restos de estos contextos funerarios de tumbas de Tiro principalmente.
Most of my work has taken place in central Jalisco state, where we find many sites from the pre-classic era.
Inicialmente me interesé en revisar todos los trabajos de antropólogos que han tratado con rituales de paso, especialmente con los trabajos de Van Genep, para ver este ritual que trata de explicar el paso de la vida a la muerte.
The main interest has been in rituals of paso, or in other words, the transition between life and death.
Y cómo la muerte no se entiende como un fin instantáneo, sino ni una destrucción, sino como un paso a un mundo distinto con el cual los vivos tienen contacto.
And particularly how death can be understood not as a destination or as an instantaneous ending, but as some kind of a threshold to communication with those who have gone before.
También un poco siguiendo los conceptos de Victor Turner sobre la liminalidad y cómo una persona cuando muere no solo deja un pequeño vacío, sino todo alrededor de él en términos sociales tiene que reordenarse, especialmente cuando las sociedades son más complejas y cuando la persona que muere es de un estatus alto.
There's been a particular influence from the ideas of Victor Turner and liminality or thresholds and the idea that when one dies, one doesn't leave a vacuum, but rather that there are lots of links, and especially that's the case when the person was a political leader.
En este sentido, los sitios o espacios como las tumbas donde se depositan los muertos son espacios referenciales que tienen una gran importancia para entender estos procesos y para entender los significados que se le otorgaba a la muerte y a la vida en este tipo de sociedades.
These archaeological sites are key for understanding these relationships and ideas about passing and death.
Bueno, en el occidente de México, desde el preclásico medio, empezamos a encontrar sitios especiales para depositar a los muertos, es decir, panteones. A partir del preclásico tardío, empezamos a notar en las tumbas de Tiro que ciertos personajes importantes no se depositan en el panteón, sino que se depositan en lugares creados especialmente para ellos.
In West Mexico, from the mid pre-classic, we found sites that are especially for the dead, which are more like cemeteries. But starting in the late pre-classic, we find shaft tombs that were specifically for people of special importance that were not put into the cemeteries.
En este sentido, los sitios en los que tenemos las tumbas de personajes de alto estatus son sitios importantes porque en sí mismos empiezan a convertirse en una especie de arquetipos en donde también observamos las ideas sobre el espacio sagrado y la relación con el paisaje y cómo se legitiman los derechos que tienen estas personas sobre la comunidad y sobre el territorio.
The high status burials are important because they show through their layout and through their construction the kind of relationship and rights that these people of high status had.
Las tumbas de Tiro de personajes de alto estatus se depositan en estos sitios que Phil Wegan llamó huachimontones y que pertenecen a la tradición Teuchitlán. Estos sitios se componen por conjuntos circulares y juegos de pelota.
The high status shaft tombs in Huachimontones are typical of the, are shown here according to Wegman in circular areas and also they're characterized by ball courts.
En los sitios más grandes, y de ellos tenemos algunos ejemplos como Arenal, Cerro de los Monos, San Andrés y Huitzilapa, usualmente las tumbas se encuentran debajo de algunas de las estructuras que conforman Huachimontones.
So in the larger sites, the shaft tombs are usually found below the structures that make Huachimontones.
Usualmente estos lugares son lugares a los cuales concurren las comunidades aledañas que dependen de ellos para realizar una serie de actos públicos que son protagonizados por la élite y que se llevan a cabo en estos conjuntos, ya sea circulares, pero que generalmente hacen referencia a la división cuatripartita del universo.
These sites were destination sites for the surrounding population that would come here for ceremonial practices, and they were usually circular, although they also showed this four division in four that represented the worldview of the four points.
Usualmente en estos sitios también podemos encontrar espacios, esto es Huitzilapa, y en estos sitios vamos a encontrar espacios que son importantes porque se lleva a cabo en ellos el ritual y que además están segregados de otros conjuntos.
So like here at Huitzilapa, you can see that there were sites that were specially for ritual and they were segregated from other sites.
En el caso de Huitzilapa tenemos un asentamiento de más de 100 hectáreas de restos arqueológicos, pero el núcleo principal donde se llevan a cabo actividades rituales y administrativas o políticas es este.
There's, at Huitzilapa, there are about 100 hectares of settlement excavations, but the principal area is what you see here.
Dentro del área principal tenemos espacios aún más segregados, como estos, en donde tenemos pequeñas plazas con acceso restringido.
There are highly segregated sites that you can see here, such as plazas that have very restricted entrances.
Como lo ha expresado antes Chris Beekman, generalmente estos espacios tienden a reproducir los arquetipos cósmicos en los cuales entendemos las plazas hacia los cuatro puntos de cardinales. Y
as Chris Beekman has already mentioned, these can be understood to represent the four cardinal points.
Y en muchas ocasiones, altares centrales que dan cuenta de lo que es un axis mundi que lleva la liga vertical entre el mundo celestial, el plano terrestre donde está la plaza y el inframundo.
And there are altars in the middle that represent axis mundi, or in other words, the link between what would be the heavens, the earth, and the underworld.
El carácter cruciforme de estos espacios ligado a los puntos cardinales lo podemos notar independientemente de tener plazas con cuatro estructuras hacia los puntos cardinales o los conjuntos circulares más grandes.
The cruciform shape we can understand to be representative of the cardinal points, whether it's in a plaza or whether it's in something larger.
Bueno, en estos casos es muy importante entender el carácter que juegan estas plazas en las cuales entendemos el este como el lugar por donde nace el sol, el oeste ligado también al inframundo por donde se oculta el sol, pero usualmente también tenemos el norte ligado con el arriba por el sol, en la posición del sol en, ese, en el cenit, y el sur ligado con el inframundo por la posición del sol en el nadir.
We can understand the east to be associated with the birth of the sun, the west to be associated with the death of the sun, and therefore the underworld. The north is associated with the sun because of its high point or zenith, and the south is associated with the underworld because of the sun disappearing.
Esta cosmovisión, esta manera de concebir el mundo es tan importante que no la vemos únicamente plasmada en las maquetas, en los espacios arquitectónicos, sino también en algunas vasijas, como este caso, en donde podemos ver las cuatro estructuras alrededor un conjunto de representaciones humanas y las huellas hacia el altar.
This cardinal point understanding or worldview is so important that it's not only present in something large like a plaza, but also in something small, in this kind of bowl, for example, where you can see footprints that are going towards the central altar.
Además, esta división cuatripartita del universo aparece desde tiempos tempranos en la gran mayoría de las vasijas funerarias.
The four-part division is very old and has appeared in the funerary related vessels for a long time.
También es importante hacer notar esta relación del sur con el inframundo, ya que en la mayoría de los sitios en donde encontramos grandes tumbas de Tiro, ellas aparecen siempre en la estructura sur, como es en Huitzilapa, Cerro de los Monos, El Arenal y otras.
In some of these sites, like Huitzilapa and Cerro de los Monos, Arenal and others, it's important to note that this relationship that between the cardinal point of the south with the underworld, because the shaft tombs are found in the south part of those sites.
De esta manera, la tumba no es solamente el lugar donde descansan los ancestros, sino definitivamente un punto liminal de contacto con el inframundo.
In this way, it's not only where the ancestors are resting, but also a liminal or threshold point of contact with the underworld.
En el centro de Jalisco es muy común encontrar sitios en donde tenemos panteones. Stanley Long, desde los 60, refirió una serie de sitios como Santa María, Las Cuevas, entre otros, en donde encontramos panteones de tumbas de Tiro.
In the center of Jalisco, these cemeteries have been studied and found for a long time, but some of them have the shaft tombs in them.
En estos panteones de tumbas de Tiro, las tumbas son generalmente sencillas y las ofrendas asociadas a ellas también son muy sencillas.
In the cemeteries that are associated with the shaft tombs, the tombs and also the offerings are very simple.
En el caso del Valle de Temajac, que es el valle aledaño a este, también Javier Galván detectó cementerios con tumbas de Tiro.
In the valley of Temajac, which is just next to this area, there have been shaft tombs found with the same kind of simple offerings.
Pueden ver estas tumbas que no tienen más de 2 metros de profundidad. La cámara funeraria también es pequeña y generalmente los cuerpos se depositan con la cabeza hacia el Tiro y las ofrendas se depositan sobre los cuerpos por la falta de espacio.
The tombs are 2 meters deep or even less than 2 meters. The heads are located towards the entrance and the offerings are placed on top because there's no place else to put them.
Este es otro ejemplo de estas tumbas y pueden ver el patrón de acomodamiento de los entierros con la cabeza hacia el Tiro, las ofrendas sobre los cuerpos.
Here you can see the same pattern again with the heads toward the entrance and the offerings on top because of the fact that the chamber is very small.
Pero las grandes tumbas que les comento, que se depositan fuera de los panteones y se encuentran debajo de las estructuras, son verdaderas construcciones funerarias.
The large shaft tombs, which are located outside the cemeteries and underneath important structures, are truly funerary constructions.
Esta tumba tiene más de 18 metros de profundidad y 3 cámaras funerarias, Estas cámaras funerarias tienen más de 2.5 meters de altura.
This tomb is more than 18 meters deep. It has three chambers, and each chamber is 2.5 meters tall.
La tumba de el Valle de Santa Rosalía que encontró Long también es una gran tumba que tiene también varios metros de profundidad y un tiro casi rectangular con una sola cámara funeraria.
The shaft tomb that Long found in Valle Santa María is also of this kind, and you can see it's much larger.
Ahora iré a abordar la tumba de Huitzilapa que me tocó excavar hace más de 20 años. Y la tumba de Huitzilapa es un ejemplo bastante sobresaliente de los ejemplos de entierros funerarios de élite.
The tomb of Huitzilapa, which I excavated more than 20 years ago, is an example of this kind of large construction funerary shaft tomb complex.
La tumba se encuentra en la plaza oeste o F4. Y ubicada debajo de la estructura sur.
The shaft tomb is found in the F4 plaza on the west, and it's underneath this large temple.
La plaza oeste tenía muros que cerraban la circulación a su interior y la separaban del resto de los conjuntos ceremoniales.
The plaza had walls around it, which made it segregated from the rest of the complex and also from entrance into the plaza.
En la parte casi central de la plataforma sur se construyó el tiro que tiene más de 8 metros de profundidad. Las entradas a la cámara se encontraban directamente sobre el tiro y tenemos dos cámaras funerarias en un eje norte-sur.
The shaft tomb was built in the center of the south room. It's more than 8 meters deep. Right in the middle, it has entrances from either side, and at the bottom, it has a chamber on either side.
La cámara norte es la de mayores dimensiones, y lo que pudimos observar fue que en cada cámara encontramos tres entierros, tanto masculinos como femeninos.
The north chamber is a little larger, and they found three burials in each chamber. Masculine as well as feminine, male as well as female.
Gracias al apoyo de Bob Pickering, realmente podemos conocer un poco de las prácticas funerarias de estas personas.
Thanks to Bob Pickering, we can know a bit more about the funerary practices of these people.
Sabemos que esta tumba se construyó básicamente como un evento funerario para esta persona, que es el personaje principal, es un adulto masculino mayor alrededor de los 40 y tantos años.
We can know that this was constructed mostly as for the principal burial, which was a man around 44 years old.
También sabemos que al menos estos otros 5 individuos se depositaron posteriormente, bueno, al mismo tiempo, pero después de haber pasado por distintas etapas de desecación.
The other 5 people were deposited around the same time, but after having passed through distinct phases of desiccation.
También gracias al estudio de Bob sabemos que al menos estos 2 entierros masculinos, estos 2 femeninos y este masculino comparten distintos defectos de la columna que implican un grado de parentesco muy cercano.
We can also know from Bob's work that the 2 female cadavers and the two male cadavers also show particularities of spinal condition that means that they were genetically related.
Esto obviamente nos indica, y esto es la parte importante de excavar este tipo de contextos, que la tumba realmente podemos considerarla como una cripta familiar, porque las personas que están depositadas ahí tienen este lazo de consanguinidad.
This is in fact was a very important finding because it shows us that this was something like a family funerary crypt because of the evidence that shows that they were family.
Observando este tratamiento mortuorio que debió de llevar varios meses para desecar los entierros, preparar las ofrendas, excavar la tumba de varios metros. Evidentemente tenemos muy claramente un patrón de culto a los antepasados.
Because this would have taken several months between all the different steps of excavating the tomb and drying out the corpses, we know that we are looking at a particular kind of cult that was practiced.
Aquí ustedes pueden observar cómo se prepara cada parte de la ofrenda, cómo cada pieza encapsula, cada vasija, un mensaje cosmológico y tiene un acomodo particular dentro de la tumba.
You can see here the layout in the tomb. You can, and we can observe that each piece has its own part to play in a kind of a worldview and has been placed specifically.
También ustedes pueden observar aquí y en las imágenes siguientes parte de esta ofrenda funeraria que implica además la intervención de artesanos especializados para elaborarla.
What we can also tell from this is that there would have been a participation of artisans who were specialized in making these particular offerings.
En estas vasijas, estas manchas amarillas son restos de material orgánico, es decir, del alimento que se coloca en ellas, y eso implica entonces también la creencia de una vida posterior a la muerte.
The yellow stains you can see inside the vessels are organic remains, and they show that there would have been some kind of belief in life beyond death.
También me interesa en este aspecto de los rituales de paso entender una parte muy especial, la cual menciona Turner, posterior a la muerte de una persona, que es el periodo de duelo.
What is interesting too to find out about these is, again, based on Turner, that after death there is a period of mourning, and we're trying to find out what we can know about this mourning period.
Y este periodo de duelo empieza desde la preparación del cuerpo, aquí, y termina mucho después de que el cuerpo se coloca en la tumba, con otro tipo de ceremonias, incluyendo tal vez la perforación de las mejillas.
The mourning period begins with the preparation of the cadaver, but it ends much beyond the period of burial, and it may have ended with the ceremony of cheek perforation or piercing.
Incluso en las maquetas podemos ver estas procesiones funerarias en las cuales viene el catafalco o el envoltorio en donde se coloca el muerto, los rituales que se llevan a su alrededor para colocarlo dentro de la tumba.
In these models, we can see what the funerary procession would have looked like, including the large, you can see them carrying what would have been the death bundle, or the wrapped up cadaver, and also other implements that are going to be used in the ceremony.
En estas, también podemos ver estas rituales de perforamiento de mejillas y cómo las ceremonias eran tan elaboradas que implicaban música, danza y otro tipo de actividades, como las que aparecen aquí al lado de este cuerpo.
We can see that in these ceremonies we have the depiction of the cheek piercings, and we also know that there was music and dance involved, as we can see from the second picture there on the right.
Pasando ahora a lo que son las ofrendas dentro de una tumba y cómo podemos darles sentido, me gustaría primero partir de la idea de que son los caciques o las élites las que coordinan el intercambio de este tipo de ofrendas y otras con sus homólogos, es decir, con los caciques de otras comunidades.
Regarding the matter of where the objects that were placed in the offerings originated, I would like to believe that there was kind of a coordination between the leaders and their homologues, or the fellow leaders of other areas.
Y como muchos de estos objetos que encontramos en las ofrendas funerarias empiezan a funcionar como precisamente marcadores de este estatus.
And in this way also, the way in which these offerings that come from other places become status markers.
Así, de esta manera, nos encontramos en una especie de círculo en el cual este intercambio vincula a las élites y también hace que se entretejan alianzas horizontales entre ellas.
What is created is a circle of trade in which the different elites from different areas are interwoven, and also a kind of egalitarian relationship among them.
Bueno, uno de los materiales que hemos encontrado en las tumbas y que da cuenta de este proceso son las ofrendas fabricadas en concha. Y podemos ver las rutas de intercambio de especies que vienen del Pacífico, de la costa pacífica, y se introducen al centro de Jalisco, a las tierras del interior, y llegan hasta Zacatecas y más allá.
Particularly objects made of shell, which can be traced, species, for example, from the Pacific, we can see how they were traded inland and as far north as Zacatecas.
Las ofrendas de concha definitivamente en este momento y lo que implican es que el intercambio de estos productos fue uno de los más activos en el preclásico.
Also, we can know that the interchange of objects made of shell was definitely one of the most high volume trade items.
Aquí, y estas, todas estas son trompetas de caracol que vienen de la tumba de Huitzilopochtli. Ustedes pueden ver este espécimen que es un Strombus costatus del Caribe. También tenemos otros elementos como la Turbinella angulata que también proviene del Caribe.
There are different species that are being looked at here. Some of them come from the Pacific, some from the Caribbean, but you can see what can be traced as their point of origin.
Estos especímenes del Caribe, junto con otros especímenes del Pacífico, tienen que tener un significado muy especial, porque siempre aparecen ligados Strombus costatus, Turbinella angulata, con especies que son del Pacífico como Fasciolaria princeps o Strombus peruvianos. Siempre aparecen en esta relación.
So what we can find is that species that come from the Caribbean there must be some great importance because they are always in the company or placed next to species that come from the Pacific.
También me gustaría que ustedes observaran cómo estos caracoles están decorados. Y un elemento que es muy importante es estas líneas en zigzag y aquí, que representan serpientes bicéfalas muy esquematizadas.
I would like you to note the importance of the decoration on these shells because you can see wavy lines that represent two-headed serpents.
En la tumba que ustedes observaron en las imágenes anteriores y que aparece aquí, ustedes pueden observar todos estos círculos rojos que es las partes donde tenemos ofrendada los objetos de concha.
The red circles from the tomb that we saw earlier, the Huitzilopochtli tomb, you can see those red circles are the areas that show where the shell offerings were.
Otra particularidad que permite ligar la concha con una relación muy clara con la fertilidad es que la mayoría de la iconografía plasmada en ella tiene relación con estas especies de ranas, muy esquematizadas, con aves también. Aquí tenemos pendientes y narigueras hechas en este material.
There were nose and ear, we're looking at nose and ear ornaments that are made from shell, and there's a definite link to fertility because of depictions of frogs and birds.
También el hecho de encontrar estas ofrendas en contexto nos permite entender las figuras que ustedes observan en esta exposición, porque precisamente tenemos las narigueras que portan, los collares en esta zona, los brazaletes en posición.
And we can link the human remains to the depicted, the people that are depicted in ceramics, because we can locate exactly where these nose and arm bands and things like that were.
También podemos pensar que estos personajes entretejen lazos no solo con las élites a un nivel horizontal, sino también con el resto de su comunidad, porque en la mayoría de las ceremonias observamos el uso de estos elementos, muchas de ellas ceremonias funerarias. Aquí tenemos el cuerpo, trompetas de caracol, otro ritual en un conjunto circular, trompetas de caracol, un juego de pelota y trompetas de caracol.
The shell trumpets would have been something that showed not just horizontal relationships among these elite buried figures, but also vertical relationships because we can see them in these models in acts of public ceremony with song and dance.
Y probablemente como parte de estas estrategias de obtener poder a través de la ostentación, en muchos de los banquetes rituales, también estos caciques pudieron repartir objetos, pequeños objetos de concha.
Probably the caciques or leaders also would have been giving them as gifts at acts, at public feasts and this kind of thing.
Este es el tipo de representaciones ligadas con la fertilidad, es decir, serpientes bicéfalas esquematizadas en brazaletes, en trompetas de caracol.
And we can see again the two-headed serpents that would have characterized these pieces.
Representaciones de ranas y batracios.
Also the representation of frogs and batracios or turtles. No. Saurios.
Antes de que sea rana. Ajolotes.
Oh, yeah. Tadpoles.
Bueno, otro aspecto también que es muy importante es otra de las ofrendas que tenemos son cuentas de piedra verde que nos dan una, reiteran esta relación con la fertilidad por el color verde vegetación.
Also the jadeite beads, because of their green color, we know it's associated with fertility.
Y también es uno de estos objetos o artículos que se usan para la ostentación porque ya hemos identificado todas estas cuentas y son jadeíta que proviene probablemente de Guatemala.
These were also used for purposes of ostentation. They probably came from Guatemala, and so they were status indicators.
Estoy muy interesada también en estudiar este icono que aparece de manera recurrente, que es la serpiente bicéfala en los caracoles, pero pueden ver este personaje de Colima sobre una serpiente bicéfala. Y en cerámicas que vienen de Colima, Nayarit y Huitzilapa aparece reiteradamente la serpiente bicéfala.
So the two-headed serpent is an object of great interest, and you can see it on the shells as we saw earlier. Also, the figure on the right is standing on a two-headed serpent, and then there are examples from Colima, from Huitzilapa, and from another location that show the two-headed serpent.
Y cómo también estos conceptos se incorporan en las mismas representaciones humanas.
And how these are related to the same to the very representation of human figures.
En este sentido, otro elemento que nos permite hablar de que son entierros de alto estatus es la presencia de espejos de pirita, siempre asociados a los entierros de alto estatus, pensando que el espejo es un símbolo que usan los chamanes porque refleja una imagen distorsionada del otro mundo.
Pyrite mirrors also tell us that there was a high status burial. Pyrite mirrors were used by shamans to reflect a distorted image of the other world.
Y como tenemos representaciones también recurrentes de guerreros, me voy a saltar mucho, pero en las cuales podemos entender que además de los banquetes rituales, compartir regalos entre sus seguidores, la guerra es otra estrategia que usan los caciques para obtener poder.
The representation of warriors, and here I'm skipping quite a bit, the warriors, the act of making war was also a way that the elites used to get power.
Y bueno, en este sentido de entender el centro de Jalisco como un espacio políticamente fragmentado, lo podemos también observar a partir de las representaciones humanas. No tenemos un ejemplo como el caso teotihuacano, donde las representaciones son uniformes, sino que tenemos la intención de diferenciarse del otro, de representar identidades distintas, perdón.
Unlike Teotihuacan, we can see in Jalisco that there was a politically fragmented landscape, and this is evident in the distinct ways that human figures were represented.
Porque tenemos todos estos estilos compartidos en este pequeño valle central.
All of these styles are represented in a small central valley.
Y un poco para concluir, tenemos estas representaciones también que son muy interesantes, en las cuales tenemos generalmente representaciones de la mujer ligada a la fertilidad como reproductora de la fuerza de trabajo, siempre a partir de observar estas representaciones en los pechos que están ligados precisamente a serpientes bicéfalas relacionadas con la fertilidad.
By way of conclusion, we're looking at some female figures who have the characteristic of being associated with fertility and also certain kinds of labor, but also having the two-headed serpent painted on their breasts as some kind of marker.
Y cómo estas figuras se emplearon en distintos rituales en los cuales se implicaba su manipulación y uso, como en estos casos, y cómo podemos distinguir también cómo hay un espacio de lo femenino y lo masculino al interior de las tumbas.
Another area of interest is how these particular objects were used in different kinds of ritual settings and how we can observe within, for example, the chambers there at Huitzilapa, how there were feminine spaces and masculine spaces.
lo podemos decir porque las ofrendas que tienen que ver con lo masculino siempre aparece al lado izquierdo y se liga con ofrendas como incensarios, huesos de ave, y lo masculino aparece a la izquierda, ligada a ofrendas que tienen que ver con fertilidad.
So the male side, the masculine side, is on the left, and with associated with offerings of bird bones, and the female side is always on the right, associated with fertility.
Y finalmente, lo masculino, obviamente relacionado con el poder y la fuerza de los guerreros, es representado en la tumba por la colocación de este elemento fálico elaborado con caracoles y su posterior representación en figuras.
With masculine figures, we can also see that in tombs there is a phallic figure made from shell that is placed on top of the remains, and then also it's represented in the ceramic figures in the way that you see there.
Bueno, yo espero que con esto ustedes puedan entender cómo los arqueólogos necesitamos del contexto para poder dar significado a esta gran cantidad de figuras que aparecen en los museos y entender cuál es su uso dentro de un contexto social mucho más grande.
I hope that with these examples you can understand why archaeologists need the context of where the pieces are in space before they go into museums, and so that they can figure out the social relationships that the pieces represented or helped represent.
Gracias.
Thank you all. You've been very patient. We've heard some incredible presentations. I certainly have learned a lot today. And I think our speakers would be happy to answer some questions. And I will bring around a microphone. Any questions? I'll hurry.
This is for Professor Beekman. You had I believe it was your pictograph that had one figure that looked like three interlocking gears.
Correct.
Is that, did they have the wheel?
Those are temples seen from above, and instead of elsewhere in Mexico where rectangular pyramids would be sort of connected side to side or at the corners, these circular buildings were connected, they looked like gears. Maybe my use of the term gear implied something else, but I don't think we have any indication that they used a wheel for anything like transport. They didn't have any beasts of burden, so there really wasn't any use to having a wheel.
In seeing some of the figures, some of the ceramic figures, some of them had their teeth showing in kind of a grimace. Is that more to say towards virility or age of the figure, that their teeth haven't decayed, or you know, they're not children?
You're channeling Bob Pickering.
Well, funny you should mention that. When I got to work with Lorenza on the Huitzilapa tomb, there were figures that had full dentitions, some that had partial dentitions, and some that had no teeth. And as a physical anthropologist, what that suggests to me is they're representing age. For most parts of the world before, let's say, the middle part of the 20th century, the number of teeth in your mouth was probably a pretty good indicator of how old you were. So I think when you see the different dentitions, that's not an accident. They're telling you how old that person is. Other questions from the graduate students? The graduate students aren't going to ask any questions? Okay. Wait just a second.
Sí, la pregunta es para la señora ya. ¿Cuál sería la diferencia entre los entierros que pasaban en Jalisco con el que hubo en Palenque con el rey Pakal?
Es un poco complicado.
pero creo que es algo similar. Es decir, en el caso de Pakal, hay una distancia temporal y en territorio. Estos entierros son del año, olvide decirlo, del año 0, están fechados entre 0 y 50 después de Cristo. Pakal es hacia el año 700, un poco menos, un poco más.
Let me go ahead and step in here. The question was about what is the difference between these burials and the burial of the King Pakal at Palenque in Chiapas, which is a Maya site. And first off, the time difference is quite large. The West Mexican was in the beginning, the early part of, was within the first century of the Common Era, and the Pakal was 700 in the Common Era.
Pero lo que creo que es similar es el concepto. Es decir, la tumba al interior de la pirámide, que representa la cueva o el inframundo, la pirámide que es el pilar del templo, la montaña, y en muchas ocasiones, como Chris lo apunta, también tenemos la representación o la idea del árbol, que es este eje cósmico. Entonces, los templos y las tumbas son también esto, esta idea de poder estar en la montaña hacia los cielos y en la cueva hacia el inframundo como lugar de los muertos. Y ambos estamos pensando en entierros de dignatarios, de Pakal, un rey maya, y este personaje, pues seguramente el líder de su comunidad.
So the burial sites were similar, that they were political leaders, and the tombs, kind of within a mountain, or supposed to be within a mountain temple, are linking the heavens with earth and the world below.
My question is for Marcos. The ceramic reclinatorio that was in one of the graves, how close in proximity was it to any human remains? Was there any indication that it was actually used in association with the human remains, like for positioning the head of or the skull?
La pieza que salió que se ve como un ave, como un ave con la cola hacia abajo. Que si la pregunta es que si estaba cerca de algún resto humano para respaldar la cabeza.
No se encontró asociada a ningún resto óseo, se encontró aislada, pero en conjunto con otras piezas.
It was found alone, it was found with other pieces, but not resting ahead.
When did the use of shot tombs cease? This question's available to anyone. Did that go up to the time of colonization, or did it cease earlier than that?
The latest dated examples in West Mexico I know of are about AD 500, just a bit north of us where we were focused. As a burial practice, though, perhaps related examples in Lower Central America continue to be used up threat to the Spanish conquest.
Para la arqueóloga, mencionó varias veces que se trataban de cacicazgos. ¿En algún momento esta área de Jalisco llegó a ser un estado, tener personajes establecidos, o siempre se nota esa diferencia en estilos y en, pues, como quien dice, entierros que no permitieron llegar a otro nivel de este tipo?
The question is with reference to the different leaders in the West Mexico area, if there was ever a time when there was a one central leader?
Yeah, state level instead of chiefs.
Bueno. Es un problema que ha estado en discusión entre todos los arqueólogos de Occidente desde hace dos décadas.
It's a two-decade-old issue of argument between archaeologists.
Está la postura de Phil Wagan, que menciona que se trata de un estado segmentario, y creo que otros colegas y yo creemos que más bien la evidencia en las tumbas da cuenta de unidades políticas fragmentadas.
So Phil Weidman's theory is that it was segmented, but my colleague Lorenza and some of her colleagues believe that no, there's actually evidence that shows a more unified political face.
Primeramente, muchos de estos caciques en otras partes del mundo usan lo que les decía, la guerra como una forma de allegarse al poder, pero todos estos casos están referidos a cacicazgos. Las representaciones me parece también que son muy distintas de estados poderosos como el Teotihuacano, ¿no? Donde tú tienes un canon de representación y aquí la idea es diferenciarse de los otros, ¿no? En un mismo espacio.
Instead of a canon of representation like you see at some place like Teotihuacan, here the idea was that each cacique needed to differentiate themselves from others.
Y otros indicadores son precisamente todas estas imágenes que están aquí en la exposición de donde los caciques participan en banquetes rituales, que también es una estrategia de poder de los caciques, el hacer grandes festines, repartir comida, repartir objetos.
There was what we can see in the exhibit here is this evidence of the caciques that they could have these feasts and be political benefactors and give away objects, and that was convenient to them.
Y creo que el problema con Phil Wagan es que él tomó un solo indicador para hablar de estado segmentado, que es la arquitectura, y hacia bueno, es un buen inicio y todos estamos gracias aquí por Phil, pero hacía falta excavar y empezar a tener más datos.
Thanks to Phil Wagan, we're all here, but a critique of his approach is that he took one factor, architecture, and decided from there that it was a segmented society when we need to look at more factors.
Un problema también es que el estado segmentario no es nada como un estado. El realmente es un modelo algo complicado y dentro del cual algunas partes parecen más o menos como un cacicazgo y otras partes que son más centralizados parecen como estado. Entonces el modelo, su importancia es más para la variación que existe en las estrategias de poder que existió.
So the model shows a contradiction between the segmented state idea and the fact that there are other aspects that really are more like a central state.
Y hay estados segmentarios de tantos diferentes tamaños, algunos muy pequeños de unos cientos o miles de personas hasta un millón de personas. El problema es el modelo, casi todos los estados supuestamente caben dentro de la definición de un estado segmentario. El problema es el modelo ya tiene muchos problemas en aplicar.
Also, the model is simply too large because it was trying to fit very small societies and very large societies into one model.
One last question. If not, thank you for attending our first international conference on ancient West Mexico, and hopefully there will be more to come. Thank you.